Today I want to talk about four things you didn't know about blockchains, Hyperledger, Ethereum, and general smart contract development. First, I will show you around the new enterprise Ethereum node under the Hyperledger umbrella. Then, we'll set up a consortium network using Docker so you can easily replicate it on AWS or Azure or put it over to Kubernetes even. After that, I'll show you sweet stuff for your development environment. We're going to supercharge your workflow. You don't want to miss this part, believe me. And finally, we're talking about code quality, security, audit, and the most comprehensive list of development tools out there you can find today. Stay tuned, we're going hands-on and we're taking a deep dive. Number one. There is an Ethereum node that is perfect for enterprises and large organizations, which challenges Corda, Quorum, and Hyperledger Fabric. If you're a developer, you probably know the XKCD comic. There are 14 competing standards, which is ridiculous. Let's try to create one universal standard. Soon later, there are 15 competing standards. It's not so different with Ethereum nodes. There are different implementations of the Ethereum protocol in different languages. Geth, for example, is written in Go. Parity is written in Rust. They both do pretty much the same thing, give or take. They are blockchain nodes. And there were a lot more of those nodes in the past. Ethereum came a long way already. Some of them are deprecated and forgotten, others are new. What does it have to do with Hyperledger or Quorum or Corda? Well, in 2018, PegaSys released a new Ethereum node implemented in Java, and Java is usually more targeted towards enterprise customers and use cases. So, needless to say, they were going after enterprise customers as well. The implementation at that time was called Pantheon. I actually made a video about that before because I personally like the client and the approach very much. I think Java attracts a lot more developers than Rust, for example. In September 2019, they migrated their project over to Hyperledger under the new name Hyperledger Besu. Besu, former Pantheon, includes several consensus algorithms, including proof of work, proof of authority, and IBFD, and has a comprehensive permissioning scheme designed specifically for use cases in an enterprise and consortium environment. So, Hyperledger Besu is essentially an Ethereum node for enterprise customers, with all the features you would expect from an enterprise-grade blockchain. This makes Besu a Quorum, Fabric, and Corda challenger. If you're developing blockchain solutions, then you will probably love the next thing. Number two. It takes about 1 minute to start working on your own private consortium chain with an enterprise-grade node implementation. Surely, some will say, well, that's not really new, Thomas. After all, there's Ganache or similar tools. They are all great, but they are only simulating an Ethereum blockchain. They are not 100% real node implementations. They are not like battle-tested and so on. Side note. This video is not a paid promotion of Besu. I'm including it because I found it useful. If you are familiar with Docker, then starting your own Hyperledger Besu network with some nodes, a block explorer, and other services is really easy. They put together a really nice walkthrough. Let's have a look at their help page. It's not all bells and whistles, and it's not 100% working out of the box for my development environment, but it's fairly easy to adapt. And in under 1 minute, you have your private blockchain with several participating nodes and everything set up, which usually takes a lot longer in any other blockchain node implementation I found out there. Let's see how it works. Basically, I do it like this. I first clone their repository, git clone, and so on. Then I edit the env file and copy the address from my MetaMask extension to the miner, so my MetaMask receives the funds from mining. Then I edit the Docker Compose YAML file to open the right ports on the host system, and that is very important, or else you will not reach the nodes. The ports are the following ports. And then I start the blockchain with Docker Compose. If you don't know how Docker works, then there is a link to a 2-hour comprehensive hands-on tutorial I created just last month. It's here. The last thing is to deploy the smart contracts either using Truffle or directly with Remix from or via your MetaMask. That's it. It's really that easy. And you get a full block explorer on top, like this one. Number 3. Development using frameworks and debugging isn't as hard as it sounds anymore or at first. When you do any software development, you are probably used to a proper IDE, code highlighting, IntelliSense style code completion, step-by-step debugging, and many, many, many more features. This is fairly standard with languages like Java or JavaScript or Python or PHP or many, many more. But how does it work with Solidity? Given most of the current Solidity development tools are not as mature as tools like IntelliJ for Java development or a full-blown Visual Studio for C#. That's a huge environment, but they came a long way already. When you are used to developing your smart contracts purely in a text editor or maybe in the online version of Remix, then here might be some alternative setups to supercharge your smart contract development in 2020. When using Visual Studio Code, you have access to a few interesting extensions. My favorite is still the Solidity Visual Auditor together with the dark theme. Now, the theme itself might not be everyone's flavor, but the extension helps tremendously reduce errors and increase readability with an integrated linter and many, many more features I expect to have in writing code, which is basically immutable. And if you didn't know the extension, then check it out. Next on the list is Truffle. If you don't used it so far for this project you're working on or for your next one, then consider using it from now on. Truffle comes with many features that ease the life of a smart contract developer. The best feature is the fully integrated testing suite. Never forget unit testing your smart contracts, and with Truffle that's really, really easy. You just have to write the tests. How do I use Truffle to do unit testing? Let's check out an example. First, I create a new Truffle project with Truffle in it. Then I edit the config file to have a development network connect with Ganache. Then I add my smart contracts as usual, well, ideally with Visual Studio Code, of course, as you see here. Then I add some unit tests. I open Ganache to actually have a blockchain running, or you can use Pantheon or Besu. Then run the unit tests and wait for the results. That's it. If I'm working in Teams and we use GitHub or something similar, then I'll check in the whole folder except the build and the node modules folder, of course, and everyone can and should run these unit tests. On top, you can have a full-blown CI/CD pipeline. It's really convenient. Obviously, there should be unit tests for everything, but how do you define everything exactly? In other major languages, there are test coverage reports. Luckily, there is something similar in Solidity as well. For this, I'm using Solidity Coverage, and this is how it works. I install Solidity Coverage using npm, it's an npm package. Then I run the Solidity Coverage report, it generates HTML files, and I open the HTML report. I'm using the HTTP server, which is another npm package for this, but you can probably just open the HTML file in a browser. It's just my habit. Truffle also comes with a developer console to directly interact with your smart contracts or even debug your smart contracts step by step. You can create new instances or debug transactions. It's really convenient to know the tools from the inside out. Let's see an example. I have this smart contract here, and imagine I'm going to update this variable. I have to send off a transaction. First, I'll connect using Truffle console to my Ganache or to my network. That connects to an open network. Then I'll create a new instance of my smart contract. I can simply interact with my smart contract now. Then I can debug that transaction step by step. I can enter the debug command in this console here, and the Truffle debugger will open up. It allows me to jump step by step into the functions and through the whole code execution. On top of that, I've started using Tenderly in combination with Truffle to know where exactly my smart contracts are failing, if they're failing. Whenever a transaction fails, then usually I don't see the exact location or the reason in the code. With proxying the RPC calls through Tenderly, I get the exact line where the transaction fails. It just saves me some time. Let's have a look how that works. I start Tenderly, and Tenderly sits between Ganache and Truffle. It's really a proxy that just proxies the whole command through. So make sure your Truffle config is connecting to Tenderly and not to Truffle. Then I start my Truffle console in this example. Let's see this smart contract here. You can see that I have a require here. Let's trigger that. We create a new instance. We send off the transaction. That transaction fails, but let's see what Tenderly tells us. It shows us the exact location of the error. Now, in 2020, there is really no reason to use Notepad for creating HTML sites anymore, and the same is true for Solidity development. Even if you don't like Visual Studio Code, then you can use the new Remix desktop. It's Remix, as we all know and love it, but it's a desktop app. It's really cool. You can browse your favorite projects on your disk, you can use the integrated compilers, and also the integrated blockchain simulation. That means you can make use of all the great features you know from the online version, like the debugger or the security tools and other extensions. I heard soon you can use it 100% offline, which makes it a great companion on travels as well. Number 4. Security, audit and standardized workflows. It's not a huge pain actually. Ethereum and Solidity have a somewhat problematic history, that's not a secret. 2 years ago, the development tools were by far not mature enough to really help avoid costly bugs. And considering that smart contracts are immutable once deployed, meaning you can't change them once they are running, it just had to lead to a few disasters here and there. Well, costly disasters. And also the community wasn't always happy with the way problems were resolved. This is not so much the case anymore. There are not only better tools like Truffle, but also great resources to learn about best practices, existing pitfalls, and more. I'm personally a big fan of the newsletter Week in EthereumNews.com. It's my weekly read on news around Ethereum. I'm literally waiting for it. Thanks, Evan. I hope you keep up the good work. Security-wise, I'm usually reading a lot on Reddit, the FDev and Ethereum Reddits, and I'm looking for community insights. One thing that I can recommend is the consensus GitHub repository talking about smart contract best practices. There, the Solidity recommendations and known attacks are a bare minimum to know for every Ethereum blockchain developer. These attacks are so well known that you will find a copy of those also in the Solidity documentation, pretty much a copy. But I like this site more, since it's so clearly only about smart contract best practices and not just another chapter in the Solidity talks. The second page worth a scan through is the Smart Contract Weakness Classification and Test Cases, the SWCRegistry.io. It's a collection of typical weaknesses and their pendant to classical CWE, the Common Software Security Weaknesses. Static analyzers are also getting better and better. Consensus and their projects are usually following a somewhat freemium model, so also their static analysis and auditing software MythX, I hope I pronounced this correctly, has a pro version which is paid. The free version checks for the most obvious things like use of deprecated Solidity functions or unprotected self-destruct instructions, but leaves out the good stuff, unfortunately. That is something like re-entrancy or transaction order dependence or many other things only available in the pro version. It's still worth a try, since it's easy to install and gives a nice report. The other thing is standardized smart contracts. There is no need to reinvent the ERC-20 smart contract in 2020. If you want to launch a system that uses tokens or something similar, or use any other standardized smart contract or library like the SafeMath library, then why not use an existing template? Open Zeppelin did an amazing job at this. All you have to do is install them through npm in your existing Truffle project. Their smart contracts will be installed in the node modules folder, and there is a lot of them available already. Then import, for example, the SafeMath library or any other of their smart contracts into your smart contract, and then simply use it. That's it. It's really that simple. I'm sure I didn't mention the one or the other thing, so let me include the longest and most comprehensive list of developer tools out there you can find. It is a GitHub repository with all the good stuff you can possibly imagine. So, now it's your turn. Let me know in the comments which of these four production hacks you're going to try today, Tenderly or the Solidity Visual Auditor plugin. For more like this, subscribe to this channel, and I hope I'll see you in the next videos.